our school. Then, on behalf of Mahatma Gandhi University School of Political Sciences, I extend a very warm welcome to you, sir, on this webinar. And I extend and I invite you, sir, to present your special lecture on the school education in the context of NEP 2020. Over to you, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Professor Tholasi Dharan Sahib. I must thank the School of Pedagogical Sciences, Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, Kerala, and a special thank to the key persons of this webinar, Professor Sabu Thomas, Honorable Vice Chancellor, MGU Kerala, Professor Mini Kutty, HOD, SPS, Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, Professor T.V. Tholasidharan, General Convener of this webinar, Dr. Sajana Jaleel, the convener of this webinar, Dr. Ismail, the organizing secretary, and all the coordinators and members of the organizing committee of this webinar. I thank all of you together. As introduced by Professor Tholasidharan, the topic of today's discussion and deliberation is on school education with reference to National Education Policy 2020. As we all know that school education is the foundation of the entire education system of the country. And of course, it is also the foundation of the national ethos of the country, cultural ethos of the country, and it builds the foundation of the national development and putting India onto the international arena with forceful presence there. For today's discussion, I have planned that I will be discussing on almost all the themes of school education, which has been discussed and deliberated by the National Education Policy. And for this, I am planning to discuss, first of all, the present status of, present scenario of school education in the entire country. And this I am trying to convey that what was the need of, the strong need of, the emergent need of, the immediate need of because of the prevailing school education system and status in the country. As I have personally observed school education changing in the last 40-45 years. And so in the light of that experiences, I would like to say something about the present scenario of school education. And on that particular present scenario, I would like to build upon the National Education Policy. I will also focus on the vision and principles of National Education Policy 2020 with a special reference to school education. I will also talk about the new structure of school education, early child care and education, fundamental literacy and numeracy, the dropout and ensuring universal access to education at all levels. We will be discussing on curricular and pedagogical aspects in school, multiculturalism, power of language and textbooks. We will be covering about that also. We will be also discussing about transforming assessment for students' development. Teachers and teacher education will also be taken into consideration, as this is one of the major theme of school education. We will also be discussing about equitable and inclusive education and efficient resources through school complexes. And for this, I would like to discuss with the help of a presentation, which I'm going to share with all of you. Hopefully, it is visible to all of you, Professor.
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay, thank you so much. So, this is the topic which we have already discussed, that is school education and NEP 2020. Now, let's see. What is the present scenario of school education in the country? And to have a discussion on this, I would like to first talk about PISA, that is Program for International Student Assessment, which is done by OECD, USA, and it is done every 3 years. And it is done with the students of 15 to 18 age group from across the world. And in 2009, India participated in this PISA test. And out of 73 countries, India was placed 72nd. So we were having second position from the bottom. So we can imagine the status of school education in India. And this PISA is basically test the ability of students from age group 15 to 18 in reading, mathematics, and science literacy every 3 years. And having observed the dismal, achievement, the lowest level of achievement, Government of India decided to not participate in the forthcoming, PISA test. And so the idea was dropped to participate in that test because no any country, no any individual, no any state want to, present themselves as the lowest in any arena of the, development. But it is fortunate that our present education minister, Dr. Pokhriyal Sahib, has taken a decision to participate in 2021 PISA test. And he has chosen Chandigarh region of Kendriya Vidyalaya and Jawahar Navodaya Vidyalaya. And he is determined to uplift the level of education, level of achievement of our students in PISA also. So it is good. But I mean to say that the 2009 result itself reflect the status of school education in the country. Then we all know the reports of ASSAR. ASSAR has been, conducting its survey for the last 15 years. And we have been reading the reports that class 5th students are unable to perform mathematics at class 3 level. Class 5th students are unable to read the text of class 2 or class 3 level. So this and that. There are lots of, reports which clearly depict the dwindling status of quality of school education in the country. ASSAR 2019 states that only 16% of children in class 1 can read text at the prescribed level. Only 16%. It also states that while 40% of students cannot even recognize letters at this level. So this is very, grim picture of school education in the country. And we must be very serious about that. We have also report of, NAST, National Achievement Survey, conducted by Government of India, NCERT, Educational Survey Division. And of course, the result of NAST is also not, satisfactory. We can see this graph. This is the report of NAST 2017. And, NAST is conducted for class 3, class 5, and class 8. And you can see here in mathematics, 64% is the average achievement for class 3. For class 5, it is only 53%, and for class 8, it is only 42%. So it also reflects that the achievement in mathematics are declining from class as we go above the levels. As the students are moving from lower class to higher class, the achievement in mathematics are declining. And not only mathematics, in all the subjects, you can see here, in language also declining, in EVS also declining, as students are moving from lower level to higher level. Similarly, you can see here in this graph, that National Achievement Survey gives its report in 2017. Here, the two graphs are there, which is comparing the achievement of students from rural and urban, as well as from boys and girls. So gender parity is also reflecting here. You can see, and you will be very happy to know, that girls are performing better than the boys at the national level. It is very good and very satisfactory. But of course, we must be anxious about the boy. Why boys are lagging behind? This is also to be taken care of. But you can see the average achievement of the boys or girls or the rural urban are not very satisfactory. It is around 60%, around 40% across the subject, across the levels. And again here, the achievement level is declining class by class. It means that the need of overhauling of school education was much required. And I appreciate the Government of India that taken this decision to come out with a new education policy. Teachers, teaching learning resources, and school ecology, we all know very well, we all are teachers, have been looking into, we have been observing how schools are going on, how teachers are teaching in the class, and what is the pupil-teacher ratio in the class, how classroom transitions are going on. We all know we are not supposed to discuss here, not needed to be discussed here. Again, I am trying to put here the Operation Blackboard scheme and district primary education program. We must not forget that after education policy 1986, the Operation Blackboard scheme came out. And within 3-4 years, the entire scenario of primary school education was changed. Personally, I can tell you about my personal experience at the village from where I belong. It is a very small village in Bihar, and that village was having almost all the houses made up of, you know, soil, mitti, tara mitti, soil. There was no any building in the village except one or two made up of bricks. So this was the first building which was made by Government of India under Operation Blackboard scheme. And in that year, it means 1986, 87, 87, 88, 18, 1988, 89, in 3 years, the entire scenario was changed because of Operation Blackboard scheme. And in almost all the villages where there were schools, the school building was one of the best building in the entire, you know, village locality. Again, with the DPEP, District Primary Education Program, the scenario was changed. So, again, you see here, Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, now it is called as Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan. With the help of Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, midday meal, the scenario of your school has got entirely changed in terms of, at least in terms of enrollment. I will not say in terms of quality, because quality is much awaited and much top concern nowadays. And the quality of your school education certainly has come down, and not only come down, it has gone onto the floor. It has gone onto the ground, and which is the major concern of all of us, the entire country. But as far as the quantity is concerned, Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan has done a great job. I can share my personal experience again. When I was a student of primary school in my village, many of you must have observed this. Many of you, all those who are above 40 years of age, I can say that all of you must have observed that the primary school building was not built by government in those days. In 70s, you can say, in 70s. And even, you know, in early 80s, there was no building at all. I remember, along with my only 10 to 12 students in the primary school, used to sit under banyan tree, sometime under a mango tree, sometime by the side of the graveyard. And of course, in rainy season, when there were chances of rain, we used and we were compelled to sit along with the buffaloes and cows in their shades for education, for learning. And teachers were so, you know, determined and so, you know, motivated and so devoted that they used to come daily and they used to teach with full devotion. So the teacher's dignity, teacher's, you know, devotion and teacher's, you know, love and affection towards students was at the top level in those days. And having observed all the scenario, my father and some other two, three more villagers thought of to build up a school using bamboos. And lastly, this bamboo, using bamboo and other, you know, wood material, a hut was created in the name of primary school Pirri. And now we had a special space, a special place to be, to go there and attend the school under that shadow. So from that day, we had a school building in the name of shade for a school. It was my father and my uncle who used to build chair for the teacher to sit on, by the carpenters who used to visit every day in the morning for some sort of job with regard to agriculture. Even the blackboard was not there in the school, and this blackboard was made by the carpenter using the mango wood slab. I mean to say that in those days, I am talking about 76, 77, 78, 79, when I was in a primary school. I mean to say that the community participation was very well. Community used to think that a school is mine. So there was a strong bond between the primary schooling and the community around the school. That relationship between the school and the community has lost at present. So you must have experienced that nowadays communities discuss about this. And if some persons are thinking about, they are thinking because they are the members of the school, you know, management committee or some other committees in the school activities. And even they are fighting for the funds for the midday meal and other. Of course, these midday meal and other funds are, you know, there in the school. This is the whole scenario of school education in the country. And so it was an urgent need to bring out with some new ideas. So there was an urgent need of overhauling of school education in particular and entire education in general, which National Education Policy 2020 has vision to do. The National Education Policy 2020 overall seems very nicely framed and worded as far as the language and the way it is addressing the educational issues, concerns, and the measures to be taken. Let us see how it is implemented and put on the ground to achieve the reality. It must act as a strongest tool to preserve Indian culture, diversity, pluralism, social cohesion, brotherhood, national harmony, and all sectoral growth of all citizens of India in general and national development in particular. If we succeed in doing this, we will be very happy and the nation will go very fast onto the international arena. Now, friends, let us discuss some important points with respect to the National Education Policy vision on school education. In the second part of introduction, the policy writes that it seeks to ensure inclusive and equitable quality education and promote lifelong learning opportunities for all by 2030. So within 10 years, from 2020 to 2030, the National Education Policy aimed at planning to achieve inclusive and equitable quality education. As far as inclusive education is concerned, I'm sure and every one of us have been, observing, have been looking into that the whole country, at the global level also, and especially in India also, we are planning and we are doing best to develop a culture of inclusivity in and around the school, in the universities, in the colleges. So visible, friendly environment are being created in the school environment as well. If for inclusive, for getting inclusive, teachers are being trained. So for at all levels and in all aspects of the education system, we are trying to put the entire education scenario, teaching learning scenario in the nature of inclusivity, so that each one of us, all students from different sections of the society, different social strata, different economic strata, can study in a good way. But what happens, what we observe, and what all of you must be observing, that despite having taken attempts to make inclusive environment, we fail to achieve that. Because there are many things which are done to make education, make learning inclusive. Automatically something becomes which are exclusive. And automatically some students are getting excluded from the system. And a beautiful example of this is in today's scenario of COVID-19, for the last 8 months, all the universities and schools and colleges are doing online teaching and learning. And when we do online classes, when we take online assessment, when we do online projects, we automatically see that basically this mode of online teaching, learning, online classes, online assessment are basically can be seen as inclusive nature, because if we provide and if there is availability of resources, computer resources, physical resources, internet facility, a smartphone, etc., all the required resources, then of course each one will be included. But because of the paucity of resources, more than 60-70% are excluded automatically. So for having inclusive environment, inclusive education, inclusive, total setup, we need to invest much more on education. That is very important. And the second one is equitable quality education. Equitable quality education is the aim of, is the vision of this government. Hope we can achieve that. And again, for getting equitable education and quality education, again, we have to do a lot of things to get it. In para 4, it talks, education must build character, enable learners to be ethical, rational, compassionate, and caring, while at the same time, prepare them for gainful, fulfilling employment. Government is talking about everything. Our education system, especially school education, are lacking in all these things. Character building is lost, values are getting lost, ethical and morality are getting lost, rationality are getting. So there are lots of problems, lots of issues in the country. And we can't say that the school is only responsible for that. We can't say that the teachers are responsible for that. We can't say. Because our learners are not 24 hours in the school system under the shadow of the teacher. No. Learners in the school are only for five, six hours. They are in the home, they are in the community, they are in the street, they are on the road, they are in the film hall, they are in the malls and markets, and they see how the politicians, how the doctors, how the engineers, how the bureaucrats, how other members of the society are behaving, are acting, are functioning. Because values and ethics are imbibed, not that they can't be taught. So whatever value system, whatever ethical system they observe around them in their 24-hour lives, in their community lives, in their social life, in their family life, they imbibe all those values. So there is a great challenge. There is a great problem. We talk of something different in the classroom, and as students are observing something different out of the classroom. So this is the problem. This gap has to be filled. Unless and until this gap is filled, we can't talk of and we can't imagine that our new generation will be laden with values and ethics. No. And that gap has to be filled by very strong decision on the part of the bureaucracy, on the part of the politicians, on the part of the government. Unless corruption is removed from the society, there are many values cannot be, nurtured in the society. Cannot be nurtured. And for example, we say that honesty is the best policy. But how many people are paying income tax with honesty? How many people are paying several types of tax in the market? You will see a lot of things in the community. Now, in 10th, 9th para, revival of teachers' dignity is being talked about by the revival of teachers' dignity, autonomy, and place in the society. As far as the autonomy is concerned, teachers are autonomous, always autonomous. The level of autonomy is very high. Teacher is the king of the class. So there is no problem at all. But the teacher's dignity is very important. For revival of the dignity, we need to do lots of job for teachers. In the same school, there are some teachers who are getting salary of more than 1 lakh. And there are some teachers who are getting the salary of just 19,000 or 10,000 or that. For the same job, there are some para teachers, some guest teachers, some contractual teachers, and different type of teacher in different states. Some are having old pension scheme and some are having new pension scheme. So where we can imagine about dignity. They are thinking on their own survival, their own security. Unless and until these challenges are, met out, it will be very difficult for us to maintain and revive the dignity of teachers in the school system. Then in 10th para, it talks about very important thing. The new education policy must provide to all students, irrespective of their place of residence, a quality education system with particular focus on historically marginalized, disadvantaged, and underrepresented groups. It's very, very important that the policy is trying to bring all the young generation, all the children under the same shadow, under the same umbrella, to provide quality education to all of them. And for this, the government has so many policies which we will be discussing later on. Now, as far as the principles of national education policy is concerned, we will be discussing in detail in different slides. But here, for just to talk about where the government is recognizing the recognizing and identifying and fostering the unique capabilities of each student. I am teaching in the field of education. I am a teacher educator. Most of you are teacher educators, and we all teach in our every class, whether it is a DLED or BEd or MA education or MA. We always say that each and every student is unique, and we have to handle, and we have to cater to the unique need of each and every individual in the class. So this is being strengthened by policy. It talks about the flexibility of curriculum, flexibility of subjects. There will be no hard separation of subjects or streams. Multidisciplinary talks about the multidisciplinary and holistic education, and talks about emphasis on conceptual understanding of the learner and going away from rote memorization. These are the principles on which the entire policies have been built upon. It is very excellent. Now, it talks about the development of creativity and critical thinking among the learners. It talks about the ethics, human and constitutional values, and also destined to develop and promote multilingualism and the power of language. It also destined to talk about the life skills such as communication, cooperation, teamwork, and resilience. So in every society, in every family, there are lots of issues, lots of problems, and people have to face so many difficulties, and they are supposed to learn how to communicate, because this is the age of privatization. And unless you have good communication skill, you can't be hired by the private companies, not by the government companies as well. So communication is one of the most important skill. Basically, this is the marketing skill. You can sell your personality. Students can sell their personality on the basis of their communication skill, their in-depth knowledge of the subject, their creativity ability, their problem-solving ability, etc., etc. So these are the most important, you know, skills which need to be developed among the young generation, and which the policies talks about. And there is focus on regular formative assessment for learning. There is a focus on regular formative assessment, like CC, which we are having. And so we are going away from assessment of learning and putting emphasis on assessment for learning and assessment as learning. We'll be talking about that also in the succeeding slides. Then there is extensive use of technology. We all have been, you know, the witness of this for the last 8 months. The entire education, entire work, culture is being, you know, techno-friendly. And so Government of India was basically prepared for the last 4 or 5 years by developing, you know, Digital India campaign, by Swayam Prabha channel, by EPG Parshala, E-Parshala, and E-Parshala, E-Schooling, etc. So there were lots of infrastructure, lots of, you know, software, and lots of e-techno facilities were already developed because the Government of India has planned in advance that the nation will have to go online. A nation will have to be a skill to be online. Nation is required to be a skill to be techno friendly and to use the resources available at the global level by using technology. And it was also aimed at providing best quality lectures of central university teachers or IITs or IISCs in Institute of Science and other, you know, teachers of high repute to all those students who are living in the rural areas or small towns. So you, by use of technology, by use of these, you know, Swayam Prabha channel, by use of E-Parshala, EPG Parshala, and other digital resources, basically this is again a step towards making inclusive education. By providing quality lectures, quality videos, quality text material, and quality projects to all those who were not in a position to access to that sort of quality resources. So Government of India has done a great job in this particular respect. Then it also has the principle of respect for diversity and respect for the local context. This is again very important. We must respect for diversity. And this respect for diversity should not only be written in the policy, but should be reflected by all the section of the society. They must respect people from all religion, people from all locality, people from all economic strata, people from all caste and all region of the country. So it should not be theoretically written in the policy or in the book, but it should be practiced by each one of us at the national level. Only then we can say that, yes, we are a country of diverse religion, country of diverse, you know, region, country of diverse caste, country of diverse economic ability. And despite this diversity, we are united and we are one. It also has a principle of providing full equity and inclusion, we have been talking about. And it also talks about developing a correlation synergy in curriculum across all levels of education, from early childhood and education to higher education. A synergy is required to be developed, which the policy is designed to do. There is again a policy principle that a light but tight regulatory mechanism framework to ensure integrity, transparency, and resource efficiency. As we will discuss in the succeeding slides, that government is planning to make a little easy for the opening of schools in the government sector as well as in the private sector, philanthropic schools. So it will be having a light but tight mechanism. So rule regulation will be there, but it will be having flexibility so that more and more schools can be opened for the betterment of our education for the young generation. Then there is continuous review and monitoring. But I am very surprised to see that government is, and the policymaker is very, very positive about and thinking that continuous review and monitoring is very essential. But I don't know why the monitoring of Swachh Shiksha Abhiyan or Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan and Mid Day Meal was dropped in 2015 or 16. So from that year up, for the last 5 years, monitoring is dropped. But this principle reflect that the policymakers and the government has a positive bent of mind that, of course, monitoring is very essential. So hopefully it will be started in the days to come. Then there is a rootedness and pride in India and its rich, diverse, ancient and modern culture and knowledge system and traditions. It is trying to dug out those value system, those belief system, those culture which were there in the country in the past, especially ancient and modern culture. Then education is a public service. Access to quality education must be considered a basic right of every child, which is a great challenge as well as the quality education is concerned. Then lastly, under core principles, substantial investment in a strong, vibrant public education system, as well as the encouragement and facilitation of true philanthropic, private and community partner participation is being, understood, is being considered. And this reflects the aim and the target of government and the policymakers, how they are trying to have a big investment in the field of education and different aspects of education. And at the same time, it also talks about true philanthropic, private and community participation. I don't know how true will be assessed. So this is a big question mark. So that we will see when the policy is implemented. Now come to the new structure. That is 5 plus 3 plus 4. As we all know that 10 plus 2 is now gone. And now we have new education policy as school education with 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 system of education. And as we can see that 3 years have been added. And that 3 years, addition of 3 years is basically early childcare and education. And so at the age of three, now the students will be getting admission in early childcare and education, that is Aganwadis or nursery schools and pre-primary schools. And from there, they will move on. So this is the new system. But have you thought about what is the basic principle behind this? I personally feel that previously 10 plus 2 was basically 10 years of schooling from class 1 to class 10, where in each student was supposed to study all subjects, math for 10 years, science for 10 years, social science for 10 years, language for 10 years and so on. And then there was a board examination. And then plus 2 means 11th science or 11th commerce, senior secondary level or arts, whatever. So there was a basis of, basically it was based on assessment. And for developing a good citizen of India, for developing, for example, developing scientific literacy among the learners, this scientific literacy cannot be developed in 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 years. So science will have to be taught to each one of the young generation for 10 years. So that in 10 years of teaching, learning of science, they come out with a good citizen having scientific literacy in them. So this was the basically basic. But now that is not the basic. 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 is based upon, I think personally, is based upon the philosophical orientation, based upon the psychology of the child, based upon the pedagogical approaches which may be used while teaching these students in different brackets of age and different brackets of class. So it is a very different phenomena, and it is commendable that this sort of thinking has been, emerged out. But at the same time, there is challenge also. So on the one hand, it is highly appreciable. Making a strong foundation of education, it will help making children extrovert, open-minded, interactive, good observer, creative thinker, healthy social habits can be developed. But there is a challenge also. One challenge is that for teachers and teacher education, if we say that this is 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, it means when students are entering from stage 5 plus to 3, there must be remarkable difference in the textbooks, in the pedagogical approaches, in the classroom transaction, in the teaching methodology adopted, and the assessment techniques, and all these important aspects of education. So if a student is in middle age group or middle level, class 6, 7, 8, and after class 8, the students are entering into class 9, that is the secondary education, and now you must know that it is only secondary, now the senior secondary has gone. So secondary stage is basically from 9, 10th, 11, 12th now. There is no senior secondary. I mean to say, from class 8 and to class 9, there must be remarkable difference between the pedagogy used, between the textbooks being given to the learner, between the nature of the classroom transaction and the assessment being taken. Similarly, for 5 plus 3, so for each stage, there must be remarkable difference. If, for me, to my understanding, if we can provide the observers, the assessors, the society, the community, that remarkable difference between stage 5 and stage 3, and again stage 3 and next stage 3, and then from stage 3 to stage 4, the foundational stage, preparatory stage, middle stage, and secondary stage. If we can reflect that remarkable difference, only then we can say that 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 is a good system of education. And it is, you know, it is reliable, it is valid, it is justified. And if we don't do that, if we can't do because of so many factors, it will be the failure of the teacher. It will be the failure of the system. It will be the failure of the, you know, curriculum planners if they are not able to develop a remarkable difference between these four stages. I mean to say that. Hopefully, we will be in a position to do that. Hopefully. So again, there is some more challenges. Linking early childcare and education with RTE would have been much appreciated. You all know, we have been discussing about our right to education since 2009, when it was made a part of the Article 21A. And a right to life, Kisan. It was linked with right to life because the basic reason was that education, life without education is what? Nothing. Hello.
Yes, sir. Proceed.
Awaaz aa rahi hai sir hamari? Voice is audible or not?
Yeah, audible, sir.
Audible? Okay.
Yeah.
There was some problem, I thought. Okay. So I'm again sharing now.
Welcome, sir.
Is it visible to all?
Yeah, visible.
Okay, sir, thank you.
Welcome.
So now, sir, so I thought I'm having thinking that this if this early child care and education would have been linked with RTE, it would have been much better. And I was saying that that zero to 3 years is also very crucial, and this 3 years to 6 years, that is early child care and education, that is also very crucial. And unless a child is healthy, having good nutrition, healthy body, healthy mind. For healthy body and healthy mind, nutrition is required. So I mean to say that if this right to education can be converted to free and compulsory health care and elementary education, then I think it would be wonderful for the entire country. And the government should take responsibility for that and for the betterment of the entire money problem. Now come to early child care and education. As I told, you know, universal, there is a provision in the policy that universal provisioning of quality early child care and education by 2030. Government is just trying to make it universal provision. And for this, national curriculum and pedagogical framework for early child care and education will be developed by NCERT. And there is a provision of that, of course, Anganwadi and pre-primary schools, nursery schools, early child care education centers are being engaged in this. But here I am also having some reason that if this development of physical infrastructure, which the government and policy talks about, that this will be developed. And I think if this is done in the mission mode, like Operation Blackboard scheme, it will be much more, you know, appreciated. And because we should not wait for, you know, 10 years for this very important and this crucial stage. I think investing 10 years will be more if this can be done in a minimum period of time. Of course, India is a big country and big resource. But of course, I don't know the problem and the economic issues related with this. But if possible, it can be done by, you know, in a mission mode as soon as possible. It will be good for all of us. Then there is training and recruitment of teachers also. And this policy also talks about that all the teachers will be trained, and those who are engaged in early child care and education, and those who are 12th pass will be trained in a certificate program, and those who are less qualified will be given 1 year diploma program for training in early child care and education. So these are very important and very interesting with regard to early child education. Care and education, and if this early child care and education is done in a good way, in an effective way, of course it will develop a good and sound foundation for the children of our country. And then we come to the foundational literacy and numeracy. The policy talks about the national mission on foundational literacy and numeracy, and the policy talks about that up to grade 3 this will be achieved by 2025, just in 5 years, which is very good. And there is also a provision that all state to plan and execute close tracking and monitoring karenge, universalization of this foundational literacy and numeracy. Then there is a provision that the pupil teacher ratio will be 30:1 in normal schools and 25:1 in schools having large number of socio-economically disadvantaged schools, that is those schools which lie in the areas where the economically lower dropout rates. And ensuring universal access to education at all levels. So this policy is destined to achieve, you know, gross enrollment ratio of 100% by 2030, which is very commendable, you know, planning. Let's see how we achieve that, because the current gross enrollment ratio is very low. For class 6 to 8, it is 90.9%. For class 9 to 10, it is around 79.3%. And for class 11 to 12, it is around 56.5%. And for higher education, it is 27.4% around as per 2017-18. And you can see that this data reflect that the gross enrollment ratio is declining as we move from lower level to higher level in education, from class 1 to class 12 and on to higher education. This is a great challenge for all of us to face this and to tackle the problem. So the government has planned that by 2030, we will be having 100% gross enrollment ratio by at least in the school level. by providing sufficient infrastructure and by providing regular trained teachers. And hopefully that each and every school will be having required number of teachers appointed. Now, it is also talking about the opening of AIE centers. And you must recall that in Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, there was provision of alternative and innovative education centers under education guarantee scheme. And many, all the states have their own AIE centers in different names. Fortunately, I was part of the monitoring team of Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan in the state of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. And I recall that there were so many AIE centers like Talim Merkaz, Chalo Vidyalay Chale, and Pahal type of, you know, AIE centers in different states. And of course, certainly in South India also, all states must have different AIE centers in different names. Government plans to again start that sort of AIE centers to have, you know, enroll all the children into the school education system and to reach the GER up to 100%. There is also multiple pathway to learning. And for this, this policy talks about very interesting thing, but of course there may be some problem in future that this policy talk that the schooling is open to now National Institute of Open School and SIOS, State Institute of Open School. Until now, NIOS and SIOS was open for class 10th exam and class 12th exam for these two. So though the students who have already passed class 8 from any school of India, they can appear in class 10th, and those who are class 10th from anywhere, they can appear in class 12. But now, according to this National Education Policy 2020, there are three different types of certificates are being, you know, programs are being, you know, crafted. This A level course is basically made for grade 3. There is a B level program for grade 5, and for C level program there is grade 8. So it means that now NIOS and SIOS will provide class 3 level examination, class 5 level examination, and class 8 level examination also. So that most of those students who are unable to join regular schooling can go for open schooling. I don't think that I will not talk about the quality of those students and quality of those type of schooling. This is another issue. But of course, they will be having the opportunity to get certificates and degrees. Now, requirement of schools, opening of schools, as discussed in the principle, there is a provision of opening of schools and less will be less restrictive. Public philanthropic partnership, non-governmental philanthropic organization will be welcomed, and some of the educational experts, they have the opinion that this basically opens the door for more and more privatization, wherein we, a country of India, a country of poor, and a country where the diversity of a long stretch, we need to have equality in educational opportunities, where we talk about equity and equality. We must provide, as the Kothari Commission talked about, the common schooling system and the neighborhood school system. So we are again going away from that by opening up the school education system to private sector. Now come to the curriculum and pedagogy in school. As we have already talked about, now the focus is on holistic, integrated, enjoyable, and engaging environment in the classroom and the school environment. So we have already this sort of, you know, curriculum in previously, but of course we were failed to achieve that or failed to apply that, and that's why there is again focus. It is being focused. I don't think, and all of you must be knowing that, of course we used to teach in our classroom holistic education, holistic environment. Gandhiji's definition of education. By education, I mean all on development of strength, you know, body, mind, and spirit, all that. So integration, integrated curriculum, integrated education, we have been talking about. We have been talking about joyful learning. We have been talking about engaging of students using constructivistic approach of teaching. So I don't think that these are new, but of course they are being, you know, they are being in the focus because we failed in the previous years to apply these approaches in the classroom transaction. Now the secondary stage, as I told that, it is now class 9 to class 12. Now the secondary stage is there and the senior secondary has gone. So all the students and teachers of the teacher education department and program must remember this. We will have to recall, we will have to redesign our memory that now there is only secondary stage, no senior secondary stage. There is of course multidisciplinary approach of teaching and learning, and there is of course greater critical thinking focus will be given for strength development. There will be focus on greater flexibility and experiential learning will be focus of teaching learning process, and a competency based learning to choose gaps in learning, you know, outcomes, close gaps in learning outcomes, and arts and sports integrated teaching will be focused upon. Then response to challenges, curriculum load to be reduced, this again there is a very good thing, and the class size is another challenge. I mean to say that there are some very important thing which I want to share here, that this policy talks about the flexibility, greater flexibility talks about. Now the students will be open to choose subjects as per their choices. Now one very big question comes to our mind, that whether the policy makers has thought about those students who want to go for medical, that is NEET examination, who want to go for joint engineering examination, JEE, and who want to go for certain specific courses. If a student of class 11th opt physics, chemistry, and in place of mathematics, as it is a very difficult subject, and he opts history or political science, you will be okay, the school will be okay, the school will teach and give the degree, this certificate of class 12th, both with physics, chemistry, and political science, because flexibility is there. Do you think that National Testing Agency, the agency which is conducting NEET examination, will allow that particular child to appear in the NEET examination? I think never. So I mean, flexibility is of course very, very good thing. It looks very better, and of course flexibility must be there, but it should not be in a blind manner. A student's career, their aspirations, their specialization in a particular area, the profession they want to enter into, the vocation they want to enter into, should also be taken into consideration. Unless there will be a great problem. I can share a few of my examples. I have been the part of the admission committee in my department for the last many years for B.Ed courses, M.A. courses, and other courses. Many a times, students qualified the test and reached the department for admission in B.Ed program with a degree in aeronautical engineering from any private university or anywhere. Aeronautical engineering, after doing Bachelor of Engineering, B.E. course, even from Jamia itself. After doing B.Sc. Biotechnology, after doing B.Sc. Bioinformatics, and we did not allow them to have admission in B.Ed program, because we have clearly written in the prospectus that we need graduation in school teaching subjects, because we are preparing teachers for the school, and so that particular candidate will have to go back. I mean, this sort of problem will come later on. So I suggest that the planners and the agencies must think in advance how to go ahead. So the modalities are required to be very clear, and it should be sent into the masses, that the children, the students, the parents must know about the after impact of this flexibility, and up to what extent they can opt different subjects, so that their career is not at a stake. I mean to say that. Now, again, cross-cultural pedagogical approach is at the point of focus of this national education policy, which is highly welcome, because we are a country of multicultural, arena, and we must respect all cultures, all languages, and all diversities. And it also develop linkage between education and culture. If the class is multicultural, if the school is multicultural, it will develop the strong bond between different cultures and education. So I already talked about the flexibility, no art separation. So I will leave this. I have also talked about the career aspirations. So I will leave this slide again. Now come to the multiculturalism and power of language and textbooks. I think it is 11:40 is already there. We were a little late. So can you tell me how much time I've left with? Anybody else, please?
Sir, you take your own time, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much. So now, talking about the multiculturalism, the power of language and textbooks. We have been, welcoming the move of the National Education Policy about making the motherland and the regional language as the medium of instruction in these schools. It's highly welcomed. Books will be also there in different languages as per the 8th schedule of the Indian constitutions. And there is also provision of bilingual textbooks for those whose home language is different from the medium of instruction, especially in science and maths. These are the welcome move by the national education policy makers. And but of course, then I think about the nature of India, the nature of primary schools. I personally feel that in most of the elementary schools, in most of the primary schools, and even in most of the government schools, you see that the medium of instruction are generally the medium which is discussed, which is talked, which is, you know, in the which the local communities is having communication generally. So there is no problem at all. But of course, it is made into the policy. It is good. But if this would have been made a compulsory, it would have been different meaning. But this word is preferably has been used for class up to class 5. It is very preferably, and up to class 8 also preferably. So it is not compulsory. But see what happens in future. There is a problem. The English medium schools, even English medium schools, those are English medium. Parents send their children to English medium schools for studying in English medium only, and I don't think that English medium schools will be be changing their mode of instructions. And if they do so, it is welcome. It is welcome. So it is up to them, because it is not compulsory. Then there is investment on language teachers also. So government is designed to invest more and more on language teachers by appointing language teachers in different schools. And there is also a very interesting provision that there is a bilateral agreement between states to satisfy three language formula. So the policy gives suggestion that for those states having paucity of teachers in a particular language, for example, if in South India, Hindi speaking students are there in the school, but they are not finding Hindi teachers in that locality, then they can, and in North India, like in Delhi or Bihar or Uttar Pradesh, there are Kannada or, you know, some South Indian languages are being spoken by some of the languages, and they have opted that particular language in North India. Then North, that particular state, UP or Bihar, can have exchange of teachers between them and for meeting the need of the three language formula. So this is again a provision which is very unique in its approach. Then there is preservation and development of Indian languages. Government, this policy talks out very interesting thing, and I appreciate that this move has been taken, these policy makers, that it plans to offer foreign language at secondary level. And these are the language: Korean language, Japanese language, Thai, French, Spanish, Portuguese, and Russian. These are the languages which has been listed there in the policy. And teachers will be available to teach these languages in case the students are there and who opted to study this language. Of course, this will open the door for understanding the culture of the world, understanding the ethos of the world, and of course it will also have positive impact on the employment in future for these, you know, students. But here again I have some sort of understanding, and my experience says that as per my own knowledge and my understanding, I see that Korea, this Korean language is spoken in South Korea and North Korea and nowhere else. Japanese is spoken in Japan only, and Thai is spoken in Thailand, French basically in France. Here you can see that I personally feel, and I personally feel, you may all agree or disagree, that Arabic language is not here. Why I'm saying this? I'm saying this because 8.5 million Indians live and work in the Gulf countries. 8.5 million. I think in no other countries of the world, no other region of the world, this much number of Indians are working and earning money and giving the government of India the foreign reserve for their export and import. And that's the reason that I think that Arabic should be part of this language group. This Arabic is spoken almost in 22 countries which are sovereign in nature in the Gulf world. So if Arabic would be there, I would be very happy to see that, because, you know, in South India, especially people from Kerala are in large number in the Gulf countries. People from Bihar, people from Uttar Pradesh. There are some region in Uttar Pradesh, some region in, you know, Bihar, some of the districts and region in Kerala, and some of the regions of Punjab. More than 60-70%. In many areas, almost all family members are there in Saudi Arabia, or different other Gulf countries. So I mean that Arabic should be there. It would have been much bearing on the future of the country. Now, introduction of contemporary subject. This policy talks about the introduction of contemporary subject, the modern subjects like artificial intelligence, talking about, then talking about the design thinking, then talking about the holistic health, then talking about organic living, like organic food, and then talking about global citizenship education, and talking about the coding. We all are listening the ads of, you know, coding and on different media. So these are the, you know, emerging subject areas of study, and this is being made the part of the national education policy, and government is planning to introduce these contemporary subjects in the national education system. So it is very commendable in that part. Now, talk on mathematical conceptual thinking. Now the policy is not talking about the teaching of mathematics, but talking about the development of mathematical thinking and conceptual thinking. So the policy has a good vision that not just teach what is 2 plus 2 is equal to 4, but try to let the child think how this 2 plus 2 has become 4. So that sort of, you know, imagination and that sort of vision is having in the mind of the policy planners and the government of India. That is very commendable. Now, it also talks about the doing what's right and children's literature towards, you know, value development. And I have already talked about the issue of values are there, values keep problem ahead. We all know that, and the government is basically trying to convey that value education will be the focus, of course, and students will be taught what is right and what is wrong. It's very important through different children's literature, by writing, by sharing, and by developing, so that they can develop different social values, human values, cultural values, aesthetic values, and et cetera, to become a good human being and good citizen of India. Then there is NCFSE in every 5 national curriculum framework for school education. Now, as you know that previous national curriculum framework for school education was there in 2005, which we have been using till date, that's for the last 15 years. But now this education policy talks that every 5 to 10 years, within every 5 to 10 years, the national curriculum for school education will be modified, will be brought out afresh. Similarly, it also talks that national curriculum framework for teacher education will also be brought out in every 5 to 10 years. So this is also a good move, because we should not wait for 15 years or 20 years or 34 years. It is not good at all, because the world is moving very fast. World is changing very fast. Needs are changing very fast. Technology is changing very fast. Pedagogy is also changing very fast. The thinking and imagination is changing very fast. And so we need to change our curriculum so that we can have pace with all those things. Then textbooks with local content and flavor. This has been the main principle of development of textbook and curriculum. Again, it is focused that we must have a textbook which is contextualized. So if a textbook is being developed in Bihar or Kerala or Tamil Nadu or Maharashtra or Delhi or where different states, it must be contextualized so that students and teachers can comprehend it in a better way. Then the textbooks, core material with discussion. So of course, in all textbooks, there is material, there is text, but in addition to that, it will be focusing on discussion, analysis, examples, and application oriented. So the textbook will be now discussion based, analysis based, example based, and application based. There is also significant reduction in the weight of the school bags and textbooks. It is very good move. Now the question is how it will be done. So this is a great challenge. How to reduce the weight of school bags and textbook. This is a great challenge. But I think that this can also be done. If not presently, then of course after 5 or 6 years. Because nowadays you can carry all your books in your pen drive. And even don't carry your pen drive. If you have internet facility, you can keep all your material on the net. And if these are the students of class 6 or class 7, class 8, 9, then if each and every class of the country is being provided with a smart, you know, television with internet facility, then all books will be there on the screen. Teachers should be equal, be techno-friendly, and they can use, they can show, they can open all the each and every page of each and every subject, you know, in any class. And so if this happens, and if this we can do, we can create that sort of resources, then I think a student will not be required to carry their textbooks to his schools. Only notebooks they will carry. And in this way, the reduction will be almost 60% in their school bag. They will be not carrying only 40, 35%. that is the notebook only and nothing else. And government also plans, and the policy also stated at one place is that in phased manner, government will provide a smart, television to all these, smart, board to all these schools of the country in phased manner, depending upon the economic efficiency of the country. So this is very good move. Now come to the transforming assessment for students' development. As we all know that there is a focus shift. Now there is a holistic 360 degree assessment. We are talking about 360 degree assessment. In one of the meeting, I was there available in, in NCERT, Education Survey Division. They are basically developing a working paper on, national curriculum framework on assessment. I was a part of that. And there we had a discussion. And I suggested that in school report cards, we generally show the achievement of students in the different subjects. So the achievement cards or report cards, the mark sheet, basically tells the cognitive domain and psychomotor domain of the child, the practical areas and the cognitive areas, the scholastic areas. This report card don't show the affective areas, the value, the ethics, your culture, your way of thinking, your cooperation ability, how do you work with people, etc. of affective domain. And I suggested that the report card should also reflect this affective domain of the child. And that particular grade in that affective domain should also be taken consideration while getting that child into admission into higher education or even at the in the job. Of course, there were people who liked that this particular suggestion. And there were, of course, some people who didn't like, because they said that we can't assess affective domain in an objective manner. But there was, of course, discussion and deliberation. We never do objective assessment of affective domain, of course. But of course, we do assessment. It is, of course, subjective. But if 10 teachers are assessing one particular student subjectively, and if all the 10 teachers are saying the same thing for that particular child's character, it becomes subjective in nature. It becomes objective. So if this report card has this particular aspect of intimating the reader, the assessor, the organization, the higher education system, then total personality will be assessed only by this approach. And there is again a question, if we don't report about the affective domain of the child in the report card, then how can we say that it is 360 degree assessment? We can't say. So if either you have to say that no, 360 degree is not possible, assessment is not possible, or you have to incorporate this affective domain part in the report card of the examination of any level, be it board or whatever. I mean to say that. So of course, the Education Survey Division, which is going to be developed for this particular assessment, they will think about this aspect and will do in a better way. Then there is artificial intelligence based software to be developed so that parent, the teachers can see the development of pattern of the child across the levels of school. So there will be digital repository for the entire duration of the child for the country. I'm audible, sir?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, now a board, as we know, that board exam is again going to be redesigned. So there is a question mark how it is going to be done. Now the board exam is class 10th as well as in class 12th also there, but they are not aware about whether it is going to be semester system there. It is going to be the modular type of board is also talked about in the policy, and how this modular test will be conducted is not well planned still. Hopefully this will be designed in a better way. And there is also a provision that there will be a main board, there will be the improvement, and best of the two will be considered for the students. It is also a good move that the students who got sick because of some disease or because of some reason he is unable to appear in the examination, they will have the opportunity to reappear in the improvement part. And so this is a welcome note. Then there is census based school exam in grade 3, 5 and 8 to assess a school education. This is very good. As I was saying in the first, second slide, that of course there is a 5+3+3+4 system. So how you are going to look into the achievement of schools, achievement of classes in different levels. So now here is the answer of that question, that that NCERT's Education Survey Division at present mode, and after some time when Parakh is being created, then they will do that at grade 3 and grade 5 and grade 8. Census-based examines, all the students will be examined by NCERT or by, you know, SCERT or by Parakh, and to assess the overall achievement of the school, and that achievement will be only used for the development of the school purpose. It will have nothing to do with the performance of a particular child or pass or fail on that. No. So this will be used only for the taking decision and moving the school towards betterment by studying the pattern of growth and development and achievement of the school. This is National Assessment Council will be developed in the name of Parakh to be set up, and which will set norms for all boards and Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan, state assessment survey, then National Assessment Survey, they will guide, the Parakh will guide to SAS as well as NAS. Then there is National Testing Agency, we have already come to know, and NTA is already functioning for the last 2-3 years, which has been there in the policy now, but it was already created, and NTA is already conducting, you know, UGC NET examination, and this year Delhi University entrance test is also conducted by National Testing Agency. So this National Testing Agency will be a nodal agency for conducting all types of, you know, competitive examinations and all type of, you know, entrance test, admission test, provided that the university and the boards have access to NTA, request NTA to be part of that. It is not binding on the university. So Jamia, we have been conducting this year our own admission test, but DU is conducting admission test with the help of National Testing Agency. So National Testing Agency will be giving the services of this sort. Now, support for gifted students with special talent. Now, we all know that in most of the schools, in many of the schools, you can see all 1, 2, 3 or a few percentage of students are gifted students, highly talented students. For those students, the education policy talks about and try to get benefit of those talent in the country. Try to filter those talent in the country. Try to give high level opportunity to those talent in the country so that their talent, their potentials, their abilities, their extraordinary, you know, capacities and intelligence may be used for the betterment of the country, for the development of the nation. And that's the reason that policies talks about a special provision for those talented and gifted students. And it also suggests that B.Ed program may also allow a specialization in the education of gifted. Not a special education, it's another thing. And it also suggests to develop guidelines for gifted children. All schools and school complexes to provide conducive environment to flourish and grow their special talent to satisfy their curiosity and zeal. There is a provision that is in all these school complexes and in all these schools, there will be science circle, math circle, language circle, art and craft circle. So there will be different sort of, you know, eco circle or eco club, you can say, wherein those students who are gifted in a particular area can satisfy their curiosity and contribute in their own development and the development of that particular circle. And so they can have the opportunity to develop their self in the best possible manner. Of course, some of them are already there in the school, like Eco Club are there in the school, Science Club are there in the school. But all these science clubs and Eco Clubs, I don't think they are very functional. Of course, in some schools, they are functional, but in most of the schools, they are not functional properly, as I have seen during my monitoring of Sarv Shiksha Abhiyan and Rashtriya Madhyamik Shiksha Abhiyan. So I think this is very good. Now, a smart classroom, as I have already spoken in the previous slide, that government plan to provide in phased manner a smart classroom to all the, you know, schools of the country. And come to the teachers and teacher education. Now, restoring dignity and place of teachers in the society, we have already discussed in the previous slide. So I'm not going to talk more about that. I've already discussed that teachers is the focus of this policy, and teachers' dignity and place in the society is being tried to be restored and restored by the country. And for that, we have so many, you know, provisions like merit-based scholarship in 4-year integrated program for teachers. There will be a provision of a special merit-based scholarship for students from rural areas. And of course, there is also a provision that after completing of PA program, preferential employment in rural areas with incentives and local housing. as the Medical Council of India provides, you know, preferential appointment in rural areas, and there is a certain sort of, you know, the in Medical Council of India, there is certain sort of, you know, agreement between the medical student and the Medical Council of India that they are required to be to serve in rural areas. In if any of the student is doing medical course from, you know, Indian Army Medical College, Air Force Medical Colleges, then there is provision that you have to serve in that college for at least 2 years. Then you can move from there. So this sort of provision is there. Then there is checking irrational teacher transfer. This is very interesting. I can all again share with you that many a times I have observed that in rural areas, the pupil-teacher ratio is very high because teachers got themselves transferred to urban areas for providing better education to their children. I have seen many districts, lots of districts. Once, for example, once I went to Lucknow district for Swachh Siksha Abhiyan monitoring before 6-7 years. And visited many schools in rural areas and many schools in urban areas as well. And it was observed that in rural areas, students were highly densely, you know, admitted in the school. There were a large number of students in the schools and teachers were very, very less. And in urban areas, students were very low. But in few schools, there were only 35 students or 40 students and teachers were 25. You can see. I discussed what is the matter behind this. And I was told that because the teachers got themselves transferred to urban areas for schooling of their children, those children who are admitted in private schools. And this is the reason that there is a teacher is much more in number in, you know, urban areas and teacher is very less in rural areas. And rural areas, strength is more because they are poor people. They do not afford to go into private schools. So they get admission in government schools. And in urban areas, people are economically well off, so they get their child educated in private schools. And those who are rickshaw pullers or home, you know, workers or labor class, they basically send their children to school. So this was the reason. Now here this policy, and I in those days Jamia had a suggestion given to that to the body that, you know, this should be checked. And here in this policy, I'm happy to see that there is a provision of checking irrational teacher transfer. It will be checked and it will be computerized in a rational manner. So hopefully that can be checked now. Now, teacher eligibility test will be strengthened and extended to cover all stages of education. Not simple TET will not be there now. For foundational stage will be different. For middle stage will be different. For secondary stage will be different. Now, the previously for 7 years, so those who qualify teacher eligibility test, they are eligible for 7 years. Now it is for lifetime. This decision was taken just a few days back. Now for subject teachers, there will be suitable TET or NTA test score in the relevant subjects. So for selecting good quality teachers, TET will also be redesigned. So this is good move. Now hiring and training of master instructors, this training of master instructors will be done by BITES, Block Institute of Education Training, or DIETS, District Institute of Education Training, CRC or BRC, etc. This is apprehension that maybe because of paucity of funds, regular teachers are not appointed in school and these master instructors are appointed in large number and the problem remains the same. This is an apprehension. I hope this doesn't happen and we can appoint good quality teachers and regular teachers in all the schools of the country. Now, teacher engagement is non-teaching activities or administrative work is also taken care of by the policy. This has been the complaint of teachers that it is the teacher who are involved with all activities. Election is there, household survey is there, any kind of service there, teachers are involved. Midday meal, teacher is involved. Now, the policy talks about that. No, teachers will not be engaged in non-teaching activities as far as possible. Now, developing caring and inclusive in culture will be there in the schools. Then continuous professional development of teachers. So teachers will be, and principal, both will be trained for at least 50 working hours a day in a year. It will be compulsory for all teachers to have continuous professional development for 50 hours in a year. Principals will be also having a continuous professional development for 50 hours training in every year. But the nature of training will be different. For principals, it will be based on workshop, managerial activities, and management related things. And for teachers, it will be pedagogy related aspects. Then there is also provision of career management progression. So if a teacher is teaching at foundational level and want to move to middle school level, if he or she is qualified for, then he can move. there is a provision of, you know, intra-state movement as well as inter-state movement. So it is very good thing, and it will be very beneficial for those teachers who want to achieve and make their career and move vertical in the profession of teaching. So vertical mobility as well as horizontal mobility is open. This is the beauty of this particular policy as far as the teacher is concerned. Then there is national professional standard for teachers. It will be developed, will be created by, you know, NCERT again. Now come to the teacher education. I was listening to Professor M.S. Sudhir yesterday. He has talked in length and breadth about this teacher education. And so I think because of positive time, I should now not talk about this. It is better to leave this slide. We skip the slides. Go to the next slide. Now equitable and inclusive education. When we talk about equitable and inclusive education, now we have already discussed the foundation of social justice and inclusive society. Basically, is possible only if there is equitable education. Bridging the social category gaps in access, participation, and learning outcomes. If we can do this, only then we can talk about and we can see the dreams of, you know, a society which is equitable and inclusive in nature. That is very challenging task for all of us. Then taking care of socially, economically disadvantaged groups. For these particular groups of the society, like beggars, rag pickers, and laborers and socioeconomically backward people. Now this government is planning to open special education zones. You must be aware that there are aspirational districts which was created under Sabsik Shabian and RMSA. Those districts which are lagging behind in literacy and education, and for particular focus on education in that particular district, number of districts were carved out in different states. And so having in all those aspirational districts, government is planning to develop special education zones for betterment of education in that particular district and particular regions. Then there is gender inclusion fund will be created by Government of India for basically enhancing, for motivating, for providing facilities, infrastructure, and for financial support to girl child and girls education. Then there is KGBV's upgradation. I'm very, very, very enthusiastic to share with you that just almost 10 years before I visited, I was a part of, member of the monitoring team for almost 10 years from 2007 to 2000, almost 14, 15. The last month, last year when it was dropped, and in many of the KGBVs, I found that girls of class 8, used to tell us and I request, sir, why this KGBV is not upgraded to secondary level, because we have a problem. After completing my 8th class, I will go to home and my parents will marry me. They are ready to marry me. This is the problem. And I want to study. KGBV, personally, I feel that this is the heart and soul of the whole, girl-child education, you can say, of the whole Sarvashiksha Abhiyan or Samagra Shiksha Abhiyan. This is the beautiful program and having the potential to change the arena of the entire country and change the dimension and arena and the, the ecology of the girls education in the country. And it was meant for those who are economically backward, who are SC, STs, and OBCs and minorities communities, and a socioeconomically disadvantaged group, and for class 6, 7, 8, 1, 10. And it was aligned with the nearby middle school. So during school hours, they used to go to the school, and non-school hours, they used to study in KGBVs. Now KGBVs has been developed as a full-fledged school. And now, after having listening to the request of these girls in many KGBVs, we at Jamia Millia Islamia and the chief coordinator of the monitoring team was Professor Akhtar Siddiqui Sahib, and when he became the NCT chairman, Professor Shoaib Abdullah was the chief coordinator, and we were the team members of that particular committee, having 8 members visiting different districts, on 6 months cycle, and we suggested the Government of India that KGBVs girls are having this demand, and we suggested that of course KGBV should be upgraded to class, secondary level. And fortunately, this was done. And now KGBV is available, providing education to girl child for secondary level. And this policy, I'm very happy to share that this policy is aimed at and suggesting and saying that KGBV will be upgraded to class 12 it is a very welcome note and commendable on the part of the government. Then there is appointment of a special educators for Divyang and CWSN children. And there was also provision in SSA also, but for a special educator with a specialization HI, hearing impaired, a special educator with a specialization in visually impaired, VI, and a special education with learning disability. So in different disabilities, a special educator was there, but they were not appointed in different schools. They were appointed in BRC, Block Resource Center, and they have the timetable with them that they used to visit different schools on different days. But hopefully, this policy talks about the appointment of special educators in all these schools. Let's see what happens. If it is done, it will be commendable in the commendable state. So we need to provide, and we have been trying to do that, making all classrooms as inclusive in nature, all schools inclusive in nature, and total inclusive teaching learning environment is supposed to be created. Only then we can dream about equal and inclusive education for the entire country. Now, let's talk about efficient resourcing and effective governance through school complexes. This is a beautiful provision in the National Education Policy. And in fact, this school complex was talked about in Kothari Commission 1964-66 also. But this was not implemented and never came to be reality. But this National Education Policy 2020 is very serious and talking about the development of and creation of school complexes. We all know that school complexes will be headed by the secondary schools, the schools having 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th class, and under that there will be many primary schools or middle schools under them. So a school complex will be having maybe a number of primary schools, a number of middle schools, which comes under the periphery of 5 kilometers of that school complexes. And this school complex will be having all sort of facilities and all primary schools in that particular within that complex, and middle schools can go and access to the resources available in the school complexes. This is very beautiful thing. If it is done, it will be a commendable job. It will be a beautiful thing. It will be having far-reaching impact on school education. One thing more I want to add here, it is related to the early childcare and education. And as I told here there that I need and I vision. Firstly, this is a personal vision. I vision that the India should have free and compulsory healthcare and elementary education up to the age of 14 years. And I also, in that light, I suggest that school complexes should also have a health center for all teachers and all students in that particular school complex. That is in those primary schools and middle schools and that particular high school, which comes under that. It is very essential because it will take care of the health and nutrition facilities of all these students. And as we have health center in universities, in ISRO, in different universities, in different government organizations, so in the same fashion, in the same way, our teachers, our students should be provided with the health care facilities. If this is done, I think it will be very happy moment for the teachers as well as for the students. It will be kind of boost and moral motivation for all the teachers. And of course, teachers may have different facilities. They would be having medical facilities, but if they have this health center in their reach within 5 kilometers in the school complexes, of course, it cannot be more than 5 kilometers, and this will be beneficial for all the students. And the government, the parents, and the teachers will be in a position to take care of the health and vaccination of all the students in different ages that's required. So now, is all the school complex will be having a school complex management committee, which will develop a school complex development plans, and all the school will be having a school management committee, which will develop a school development plan. So this is also there basically. Then there is a concept of concept of twinning or pairing of one public school with one private school. This is again a very new thing, but I have apprehension. There is a provision that one public school and one private school will be twinning or pairing with one another, and through this they will be sharing their resources, their teachers, and their students on different occasions. I think that if it is done, it is well and good, very excellent. It is excellent, but I don't think that the good public schools will be ready to pair and share their resources with government schools. But if it is done, it is wonderful. I think if it is compulsory, it would have been more interesting. It should be binding. I think it should be binding, because this is the national responsibility on the part of the, you know, private schools who are being provided land on a minimum price. And that is the moral responsibility of the private school management to provide and to support those students who are unable to get their admission in the private schools. So just merely giving suggestion, I think, should not work if it is made compulsory and binding upon the private school. It would have a different impact on the entire arena of school education. Then there is also provision of Bal Bhavan in the school complex. Bal Bhavan, where students from all the schools within the school complexes can visit once a week or twice a week, whatever, depends upon the situation, and enjoy in Bal Bhavan, which will be full of resources and for playing, for gaming, for entertainment and for learning, and etc., etc. There is also provision which is very interesting and very commendable, that it talks about the Samajik Chetana Kendra. I recall my primary, you know, stage, where I was a student of, you know, class 3, class 4, and there was no any building in the village where Bharat, you know, Bharat, you must be understanding, the collection of people used to come with the groom to the bride's house on the occasion of marriage. And Bharat used to sit in the school campus when the school was developed under Satish Abhiyan, because this was the only place where Bharat can sit and enjoy. Beautiful place, having, you know, flow. So now this policy talks that Samajik school complexes as well as different schools should be used as a Samajik Chetana Kendra. That the school can be used by the community, by the society for celebration, so different sort of celebration like school foundation day or village foundation day, or any sort of program can be organized in non-school hours. This will help in developing a strong bond between the school and the community around the school. Then there is again very good provision that building culture of reading in school library in villages. Not in school, I am saying. The policy talks, as I understood, that a school library will be opened in the villages, not in the school only. A school may or may not have a library. I don't say that. Policy talks that a school library will be available in villages for the children in non-school hours. If we talk non-school hours, so the school is closed, so the school library is also closed. The school library may be in the campus of the school, of course, but the school library will be open in non-school hours so that the students can go and read there. So it will be kind of effort and to develop the habit of reading, habit of, you know, studying on the part of the learners. It is a beautiful move. Now come to the standard setting and accreditation for the school education program. As this policy talks, that public education system a necessity for a vibrant democratic society. This is very essential. We all know that. We have been demanding that, and we have been demanding that basically this is the basic necessity of life. As a right to life, when we talk about right to life, we say that education is essential to make your life better, richer, joyful, and all the other facilities which are required to lead a good life. So education is essential for that. And for that reason, education should be the sole responsibility of the government, of any state. And for that reason, the school should be in the hand of the government only. It should be provided by the government, not by the private sector. Because as soon as the private sector enters into school education, now from that moment, we can't talk about equality and equity. We can't talk about it. Both things cannot go together. So government and the policy accept that public education system a necessity for a vibrant democratic society, but because of so many reasons, because of financial constraints and because of the population load in the country and so many other factors, government is probably compelled to allow private sector in education, school education as well as and higher education also. Then there is a provision of a state school standard authority. This will be developed. A state school standard authority will be developed. It will look after the school education system develop the policies and everything. Now it will not be under, schools will not be under the school education department directly. It will be under SSSA. The SCRT, academic matters and curriculum and academic standards will be set by SCRT, and administrative matters will be taken care of by SSSA. There will be also a provision of SQAAF, that is School Quality Assessment and Accreditation Framework, will be developed by NCRT. And in the light of this framework, the entire nitty-gritty will be we talked about, we decided for a school education. I think much time I have taken. I'm sorry for that. We started a little late and we had some problem during the presentation and discussion. And so it is too late. I'm very sorry for all these things. And I thank you all for giving me the opportunity to interact with all of you. Thanks a lot. And I would like to wind up. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Jasim Ahmed sir, for your wonderful session on school education and National Education Policy 2020. It is happy to inform you that our Honorable Pro Vice Chancellor, Professor C.T. Arvind Kumar, sir, has joined with us. He will deliver the valedictory address now. Yes, sir.
Well, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. You are audible, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, very good morning to all. Dear director of the school, Professor Menikutty, my dear friend and general convener of the webinar, Professor Tulasidharan, Dr. Sajna Jaleel, Dr. Tamarasheri, and other faculty members of the school, the most respected speakers, I see Professor Jasim Ahmed, participants and my dear friends. I have a high appreciation for this program since the first and foremost requirement of the analysis of a new policy is to understand the policy in its right spirit, real sense, and be it any policy, education or any other policy. So this is what you have done now. In fact, it is a responsibility of any educational institution as well as educationalist to clearly understand the policy first and then analyze it. In this context, I understand that you have invited the very same people who were part of designing the draft policy, which is highly appreciable, and you could get the first-hand information of the concept. The extreme relevance of this topic is that it concerns our country's education policy. This is very important. Our country is going through a new phase of development. In fact, it started with the so-called economic development. We are in a situation that education is now global. This has several facets. It's not very simple. On the other hand, the education system in India is very different, which is connected with the great diversity of our country. Our gross enrollment ratio in higher education is about 28-29%. That's what I understand. Whereas in developed countries, this is more than 80%. In certain countries, this is much more than 90%. So the first and foremost issue is that we have to bring this to at least 50%. That is what government wanted. Again, we have to realize the fact that our cities and villages are very different. These two are far different. I would say the cities, the situation in cities are far different from the villages. In certain areas, the GER is far less than 20% in different corners of India. So my point is that any policy we design, it should bring this value to more than 50% or even more, then it should be a welcome decision. The policy is welcomed. So any policy which can bring up the socially and economically backward communities in our country, it should be welcomed. Now, any policy which can bring up the intellectually challenged or physically or mentally challenged people, it should be welcomed. We have to welcome that. So the point is that the success of any education policy in our country, which is a diversified society in many respects, lies with the upliftment of all sections of society. As we know that this is the first time we are trying to make a radical shift in our education policy after 1986. This involves both school education and higher education. I'm not going to the merit or demerit of the policy. We are now at 2020, where technology is advanced to a new horizon. The online education is now very popular in the world. So, how accessible is this for a large population of people in our country, in remote places, including the tribal areas? This is another side of it. So on the one hand, we have high technology with us. On the other hand, this is not accessible to a section of people. So this is the inconsistency in our country. This is the case with any such issues. This online, which I just highlighted, is only one side of the issue. There are other contradictions too. So the policies must carefully address all these issues. Now, another question is related to states' rights on the design of various methodologies, and also the question of involvement of private participation. I'm very sure that you must have discussed all these issues. Now, how far we are prepared to face the system of dealing in the affiliated colleges and universities? Are we completely ignoring the system? Or if we can dealing, what would be the system of quality control? How the question of economic, cultural, social issues be addressed? So all these are one way or other way pending issues, particularly when we implement the policy. This is very important. Implementation of any policy is altogether a different matter. Now, this is a real challenge. So I'm sure this can be addressed only after a complete academic and economic understanding of the policy. This is what you have done now. I am very sure that the students and faculty of the School of Pedagogical Sciences, as well as the participants, are able to give others a direction on the pros and consequences of the policy. So I also request the members of the school to help our university to completely analyze the policy, particularly when it comes to the stage of implementation. I again highlight that we have a degree of appreciation to the school for organizing this elaborate program, and you must continue to take lead in organizing similar programs. With these few words, I conclude. I wish all the very best for the participants, and thank you all. Thank you very much. I have another job, isn't it?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm trying to share it. Second, I'll just. Yes, I think I am. Can you see this?
Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay, thank you. So this is National Education Policy 2020. Okay, so webinar. So this is, I think this is a very good exercise. In fact, I remember last time also Sajina gave me this job. So the moment it is over, I think you have the so-called kind of proceedings with you. Okay, excellent. Very good. Thank you. Yes, I am also here. Okay. Thank you very much. Okay.
Professor T.V. Tulasidharan sir, please proceed.
You're not audible.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello.
You are audible.
His and our today's chief guest, our Jasim Ahmed sir, for his excellent presentation with a very good PPT. Has explained many aspects of the school without any confusion. He has explained every aspects, starting with our education policy, education programs for the last 45 years, and is very very excellent presentation. I thank you, sir, for your excellent presentation in this context, and. And also, I for the last all the person those who are working the successful completion of this webinar from the very beginning of the planning of the webinar, so many people participated for this webinar. So I have to thank them. From the very beginning itself. The first day, the second November runway, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Mahatma Gandhi University, Sabu Thomas sir, has inaugurated the webinar. And that for N. E. Varghese sir, the Honorable Vice Chancellor of National Education Planning Administration, an innovative and exhaustive lecture regarding the higher education system, and on the very Dr. Vasudha Kamath, the member of the Dark Pink Committee and former Vice Chancellor of University of Mumbai, has explained the restructuring of higher education. And that's why this very valuable. And second day, Dr. Professor Ramachandran sir and Professor Sahu sir, Ramachandran sir has made a very clear question regarding the curricular also. Yes, share his views and expressions regarding the protection of the curricular aspects in this policy, and followed with our Sharma explained a very good narration about the making of, he has made a very good historic account of the making of NEP and also all other policies of education, and also the M.A. Suthi sir, he said teacher education, has made an interesting and elaborative explanation regarding the teacher education program in the context of NEP 2020. And also today, the sixth of the last day of this the webinar, our Professor Abu, Professor Jasim Akham sir, explained the almost all the aspects of school education program in and a very silly aspect regarding the transfer of teachers also as mentioned. And I am very thankful to you, sir, for on behalf of the committee, I sincerely thank you, sir, on this opportunity to thank our organizing committee for the committee. Members, administrative charge, administrative charge based on the School of Pedagogical Sciences, and a special thanks to our head of the department, Dr. Nikki, and the very esteemed participants. I thank each and everyone, those who are directly or indirectly participating in this seminar, and the rapporteurs, Andrew Kritis, Shane Joseph, and all the persons, those who are closely associated, especially the organizing members of the coordinators, Dr. Ismail Tamarcheri and Mohammed KV and Sibu G. Netto, and the organizing committee members, Professor Jayadis, and our Sajana Jalil, convener of this program, Dr. Sajana Jalil. I thank each and every person, those who are involved in this webinar,
Hello, sir.
Invite on School of Pedagogy, Dr. Medikuti K, to propose out of time.
Sir, hello, sir. Professor T.V. Tulasidharan.
Yes.
Hello, sir. I think before vote of thanks, we can take one or two observations or feedback from the participants.
Sure.
Okay. Hello, dear participants. Due to the paucity of time, we have not conducted the open forum. Now it's the time. A limited number of participants can interact with the resource person, and they can express their feedback also. Please, it's your time.
Because of the paucity of the time. Please see.
If any participant wish to speak, they can.
Respected organizations, I am very much thank well, beautifully organized and well defined. Your kind support. Thank you very much. Myself Mohinder Kumar Jenna, research scholar, Vishwabharati, journalism, mass communication department.
Is there anybody wish to speak? Is there anybody wish to interact? Professor Asha Javi, madam. Professor Asha Javi. Professor Asha Javi, madam, raised some questions in the chat box.
Yes, sir. Sir, is there or not?
Yeah.
Okay. And it's very nice. The sessions were very well chosen and well presented, and the resource persons were superb. Selection, and I congratulate Professor Lossidharan and the general for making this event a wonderful one. It's a landmark in our pedagogical science webinar series, really. And I have a query to this speaker. Sir, if you can say, spare a few minutes, like 4.26 of the report. It is said that in the paragraph 4.26, it is said that every student will take a course during grade 6 to 8. Suppose one child has taken carpentry, as is mentioned, carpentry, electronics, and electric work, metal work, etc. And if a student has taken carpentry in grade 6 and excelled in the skill, being it his ancestral skill, we assume like that. And at the age of 14, he may enter into a startup with carpentry. And he can very well support his family. It's likely that he will take a leave from his schooling. Will he be permitted to leave before the age of 14? There is no mention. I have not seen any mention in the policy. That is why I'm asking this. And if he is allowed to, he is permitted to take the leave. And after 10 years, say 26 years, he wanted to continue his studies. Will he be able to join back his school? Or if he is shown open and distance learning, then will it be injustice and a right violation on his part? Means when we speak about empathetically about with us on his side, will it be a right violation? And if he is admitted back in the school, will it not disturb the age homogeneity of the class structure? Sir, how will we deal with this issue? Means when it is.
Professor Asha, madam, it's a very wonderful question. Very good question. And I think yes, you are, madam, you are. Yes, you are saying something.
Professor Asha. Yes, sir. Yeah. I'm not audible. Am I audible,
no,
sir?
You are audible.
Shall I repeat?
Yes, audible. Can I speak now?
Yeah, sir. My question is over.
Okay, ma'am. Your question is wonderful, but two, three important things I want to mention in responding this question. And number one is that as far as this modality is concerned, still the modality is not, you know, is not created. Modalities are not determined still now. So once the policy is implemented and the modalities with regard to this vocationalization of education is framed, only then we can have clear-cut vision how to go ahead. So I think this question cannot be, probably I can't give it in black and white, number one. Number two, as you said that, suppose in class six, a student adopt carpentry, it is his family profession, and then study carpentry to class 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, 11th, 12th. The first most important thing which comes to our mind is that if a child is having carpentry as the family profession, try to be think with a rational mind. If my family profession is carpentry, then carpentry I can learn without going to school, with the help of my father, fellow workers, fellow family members. Why should I opt carpentry again in the school? What should be the benefit? If I have to go into the carpentry profession, then what is the need of getting that sort of, 10 years of schooling, 12 years of schooling? So this is again a question mark. So generally, what will happen? Generally, every individual in the society needs to have vertical mobility. Needs to develop his morale, his level in the society, and wants to move from the level he or she belongs to a higher level. And so I don't think a son of a tailor or a son of a carpenter, a son of a blacksmith will opt these vocations. I hope that these students will opt some other vocations wherein they can excel and they can contribute in the vertical mobility of the family. So these are the issues which will come onto the surface when this scheme is implemented in the real time. I think Abhi, at this moment of time, we can't say more about this. Thank you.
Okay, distinguished guests, dear participants, ladies and gentlemen, now we are reached the end of 5-day national webinar on new national education policy 2020. With due respect and gratitude, I invite honorable head of the department and patron of this webinar, Professor Dr. Minikutty A, for delivering the concluding remarks and vote of thanks. Madam, please.
Thank you, Ismail. Respected Pro Vice Chancellor, Mahatma Gandhi University, Kottayam, Professor C.T. Aravindakumar, the speaker of the day, Professor Jasim Ahmed, IASC, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi, Professor T.V. Tulasidharan, General Convener of the webinar, faculty members of School of Pedagogical Sciences, my dear participants, students and friends, Eva, to you all. This is the concluding day of the 5-day national webinar organized by School of Pedagogical Sciences on National Education Policy 2020 from 2nd November to 6th November. First of all, I would like to place on record our heartfelt gratitude to our Honorable Vice Chancellor for motivating us and giving all support for conducting such educational endeavors. Thank you, sir. Our Pro Vice Chancellor is with us in this valedictory session. In his busy schedule, he accepted our invitation and agreed to spare some time with us. Gave us an insightful speech on national education policy. Thank you, sir, for all the generous support given to School of Pedagogical Sciences. I would like to express my deep gratitude all experts and resource persons for delivering informative and useful talks on different aspects of national education policy. Professor T.V. Tulasidharan is the general convener of this webinar, who has put a lot of efforts for the successful conduct of this webinar. I thank Professor T.V. Tulasidharan and all faculty members and students of School of Pedagogical Sciences for their wholehearted support and committed work, which made this webinar a grand success. The real persons behind the success of the webinar is the participants. We were lucky to have such a nice group. We interacted well with all speakers. I thank all the participants who attended the webinar actively for these 5 days. Thank you all.